Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Shabbat Shalom.
You know, when I was growing up, I heard a phrase that was like a cliche. I heard it many, many, many times from my mother and my grandmother and so forth. They were constantly, and anybody from the South is going to recognize this, I guarantee you. I heard these words: young man, you're getting too big for your britches.
Yeah.
You ever hear that? You're getting too big for your britches. And I don't know that I ever understood that. But today, our Torah portion is from the 9th chapter of Deuteronomy. And oddly enough, I have placed a title on it that's quite a long title. Moshe reminds Israel, don't get too big for your britches. What's happening in this chapter is Moshe knows that he is at the end of his life, and he is doing a discourse with Israel, and he is reminding them again of the sins of Israel, which really and truly is an encouragement for people to not sin, to oppose sin, and to live a righteous life. But you know, sometimes we need to be reminded that we are by nature a sinful people. And without the Messiah, without His influence in our lives, without the Torah, in fact, what does the Torah tell us that keeps us from sin? Is the Torah. The Torah. And so when I look and think about all of the things that the Torah has taught us, and we examine those things and we apply them to our life, we begin to see how we can walk, truly walk in the Messiah, and walk according to the way, as Yahweh puts it, that we're safeguarded, that we are walking in the realms of life, and we are avoiding the realms of death. This is Moshe's heart. This was his heart to the people back then. And I think it really is the heart of every teacher of Scripture, is really wanting the people to understand what it means to live a righteous life and what the rewards of living a righteous life are and what the dangers of living outside of that is to each one of us. And so I believe that Moshe loved Israel with every fiber of his being. When a man will stand there and tell his Creator, I would rather you cast me into outer darkness. I would rather have you remove my name from the book of life if it'll save my people. Boy, what a heart that is. I mean, you know, I would say there's probably some of you who have felt that very way. There are things in our lives that are going to be a constant reminder of His presence in our lives. And it's how we accept that presence. We can accept it openly and rejoicing, or we can say, well, He's in our life. And a lot of people, believe it or not, what I'm about to say, they think He's meddling in their business. Well, I can only tell you this. Praise Yahweh's name. He can meddle in my business anytime He wants. He can correct me anytime He wants. And I'll just share with you, this week, He did correct me. Okay? And I'll just share this tidbit of information. I made reconciliation, which is what He called me to do. And I appreciate the fact that some of you pointed that out to me last week. And so I did do that. And I'll leave it at that. But I want you to look today with me at the words that Moshe tells Israel. I want you to look first of all, and we've studied some of these things many times. I want you to really, really read these things. Okay? Hear the heart of Moshe as he looks at the people of Israel, as I look at you today. And he says, "Hear, O Israel. Hear, O Israel." You know what his heart is? Don't miss this. Don't let this go by you. Hear this. Okay? Pay attention to this. Be prepared to do something. There is something that is required of you and me. Let me back up. He says, "You're passing over the Jordan today to go in to dispossess nations greater and stronger than yourself, cities great and walled up to the heavens." Now notice, within this verse, we begin by saying, "Hear and go." Do you see that? "Hear, O Israel." That means hear and go. That means listen, do something. It's a request for both. It isn't just a request to say, "Listen to my voice," and then don't do anything about it. And it isn't also go out and do something according to your own dictates. It's listening to His word and doing what He is commanding you to do. Doesn't matter what your pastor says. Doesn't matter what anybody says. It matters what He says. "Hear, O Israel." Shema makes a big difference. During my ministry time, I've experienced three groups of people. I've seen those who hear, then do. They have learned Agadah. Now these probably are new words to some of us, and I'll explain them. They learn Agadah, which is the spirit of the Torah. It is the part that says, "Listen. Listen. Learn. Take this in. Get this into your being. Make this a part of you." Then this results in Yada. When I begin to listen to the truth and I take that into my inner being, then and only then can I Yada, the creator of heaven and earth. Only when I have learned about Him can I really know Him. So it begins with reading about Him and then not stopping there, but beginning the process of studying so that I Yada, I know Him, I have that personal relationship with Him. Once that's established, then and only then can I function as He's created me to do. Without that relationship, I'm just blindly stumbling through life. I'm trying to make it on my own merit, and I can never do that. I'll never be good enough. Have you ever heard anybody say, "Well, I'm going to wait until I get my life straightened out"? You won't ever get your life straightened out. It's not going to happen without Him. You need Him to straighten your life out. Now that they have the relationship, they are well able to have another word, halakha, the ability to walk out what they have learned. So first of all, we have to have agadah, which is the learning process. It is the assembling of wisdom and knowledge and taking that into our inner core, into our heart. Once we have that established there, then we can begin the halakha, the walk, to walk out these things. The halakha is really the seal of a mature believer. An immature believer is one who has assimilated the information but does nothing with it. And that's pretty much useless, isn't it? If I know, it's like my friend Stan, works on aircraft. Requires a great deal of knowledge. He studied to know how to do what he does. But if he learns how to do it and doesn't do it, what good is it? How many airplanes are going to get built if he says, well, I know how to do it, but I'm not going to do it. You see what I'm saying? Torah is no different. I've got to know about the Torah and what he requires of me, and then I can begin to walk that out. But I can't do it unless I'm doing it hand in hand with him. If I'm walking hand in hand with him, I can do anything. That's nothing right. Is impossible for me. Right. But apart from that, what does he tell me I can do?
Nothing.
Nothing. Zero, zip, nada. I can't do anything, he says. Agadah does not function without halakha. And halakha does not function without Agadah. Did you miss that or did you get that?
Got it.
Can't have one without the other.
Symbiotic.
I can't walk it out if I don't have it. I mean? And if I'm trying to walk it out without it, if I'm trying to have a halakha without Agadah, then what am I doing? I'm walking according to the dictates of man. Which is, by the way, I think is what's happening in a lot of instances. We have people who are trying to establish their own Torah, who are trying to rewrite it and make it what they want it to be. If I don't like what the Creator of heaven and earth says, then I'll just change it and I'll make it acceptable to me. That's what happens oftentimes. This explains the expressions spirit of the law and the letter of the law. The spirit of the law is which one of those?
Agadah.
It's the spirit of the law. It's something I can't see. It's something that is in the Torah that Yahweh is presenting to me, but I can't see it, touch it, feel it, smell it, taste it. All right? But it becomes the letter of the law, halakha, when I walk it out. When I take that information that I've assembled, assimilated, and I begin to walk that out. I begin to keep the Torah. I begin to do the commandments. Now you begin to see that we have a huge society of people who are agadah but have never made it to halakha. They don't think they have to walk those things out. They don't think they have to live the information they've assimilated. They think that it's enough to just have knowledge. This is Greco-Roman thinking. It's all about knowledge and wisdom, and not about walking it out. James 4:17, who says this, to him then, who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Now I want you to pay attention, because I don't want anybody to mistake these words as coming from me. I didn't write them. But I want you to pay attention really and truly to what they say. Let's look. To him then who knows to do good. All right, I have Agadah. I've read it, I know what it says, I know what it tells me to do. It tells me over and over and over and over that I am to do these things, but I say I'm not going to do them. What does James tell you that is?
Sin.
Sin. To know to do it and not do it is sin. So, if Yahweh has told me in the Scriptures that I am to do His commandments, I am to keep His commandments. By the way, did He ever tell us that?
Yeah. And over.
How many times? Over and over and over and over and over. Hundreds of times. And I know that that's what it says, but I say I'm not going to do it. It doesn't apply to me. I don't need it. James says that it's sin. Not this James. Yaakov in Scripture says that. I mean, it isn't my words. If anyone knows what to do, agadah, but fails to do halakha, he commits sin. I know these things are hard to swallow sometimes. We just don't want to accept that. We just, you know, some people would say, what doesn't say that? Well, it does say that. I just told you where it says that. Right? But we have a lot of people who are in denial and they say, well, it doesn't say that. No, it doesn't say that anywhere. Well, it only says that like hundreds of places. I mean, as believers, we are told that we will face nations stronger than we are. We are told that they are greater than us. We would face strongholds. Those are real comforting words, aren't they? Why do you think that Yahweh tells you and me, in this life, in this walk, you're going to come against nations that are far stronger than you are?
So we will go to them.
Notice that? He says, they're greater than us. And that we're going to face strongholds. The last thing that most people want to hear are those words. We don't want to hear that there's nations stronger than we are. We're the United States of America. There's nations out there that outnumber us 5 to 1 probably. Maybe even more. I don't know. I'm just putting out a number. But is it going to be a 200 million man army? Do you realize, folks, that's the whole United States almost? If you count the census, how many people are there in America today? I don't remember the last census count. But that's a lot of people, 200 million. There's going to be a 200 million man army come against a little country called Israel. Now, whether you and I realize this, we are that country. We are those people. We are Israel. It isn't just they're going after those people that live over there in that little strip of land. You are going to live over there. Right? You are Israel. They're going to come after you right here. The other day, I saw a picture that was supposedly taken in Los Angeles, California, and it showed on a street there in a like a plaza, as best I can describe it, 37,000 Muslims praying. It was an ocean of them. We don't realize there's that many in this country. And that's just a small number.
And that's just them.
That's just a fraction, okay?
China.
Deuteronomy 9:2 says, a people great and tall, the descendants of Anakim, whom you know and of whom you heard it said, who does stand before the descendants of Anak? Now that sounds really terrible. I'm envisioning giants, right? And there's a lot of people who believe that's what they are. And I'm not saying they aren't, okay? But I'm telling you this, did Israel know about them according to that verse?
Yes.
He tells us right there, whom you know. Mm-hmm. They aren't some secret society. Israel knew about them. I shared with all of you the other day, I saw a giant. I'm 6'2". I came across a guy right in the building right next door over here that when he went in to register his car, he ducked like that. And when I walked up beside him, I came to right here, top of my head.
Wow.
I asked him, I said, how tall are you? 7'11".
Oh.
Okay? I am a midget compared to that guy. Right? So I can look at him and say he's a giant to me. Doris and I I guess she was a grandmother and her grandson who used to come into one of the restaurants down here, and he would fit the definition that I'm about to show you here. But let's look at how it defines these people, these Anak, okay? It gets worse. We also face the Anak. The Anak, as you see, means long-necked. Yahweh says, who stands before them? Now, the grandmother and a grandson, the grandson, and I understand there's a name for this, mm-hmm. he has a really long neck.
He could get it broken easily.
Yeah. His neck is probably that long. Okay. And the African tribes, remember the women that stack mm-hmm. rings and they keep stretching their necks?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, the question I have to ask myself is this. What is a giant? Was Goliath a giant? He was 9 feet tall. Is that unheard of? My wife's dad knew personally a gentleman who was 9 feet tall. Worked for Red Wing Shoes.
Weatherbird Shoes.
9 feet tall, he would come home after going on his tour, place $100 bills on his shoulder, stand flat-footed and say, if you can stand flat-footed and reach the $100 bills, you can have them. Okay. He's a giant, right? We would look at him as a giant. Well, what I want you to see is this. Israel knew about them, and it says, who stands before them? Pay attention to this. What does it mean to stand? It's the Hebrew word here, yasab. The action meaning is to stand, and the abstract meaning is truth. So what is Yahweh really asking here? Who's going to stand before the Anak with truth? Who's going to represent? Because you know what's going to happen? You're going to see the huge size and be afraid, and fear is going to keep you from functioning. We have so many people who are so wrapped up in fear today until they can't function. Well, I know this. I don't care if they're 13 feet tall, 16 feet tall. I serve an Elohim who's bigger than any of them. Right? So no matter what really they are, I know He's bigger than they are. Right? And if I keep reading, I'm going to see where they're nothing compared to Him. So I don't trust in my own size and my own strength to beat them. But may I say this to you, and I say this with all sincerity. I never knew personally a Green Beret in the military that couldn't have taken the 7 foot 11 inch man over here and brought him down to nothing before you could blink an eye. So just because a person is big doesn't mean a whole lot. You ever hear the term, the bigger they are, the harder they fall?
Yeah.
It's what you know. And what do we know? We know an Elohim who's bigger than our circumstances. Amen? So, who's going to stand before them with truth? Are you going to stand before them and teach them and preach to them and share the message of truth with them? Or are you going to cower away from them? That's really what he's saying here. Who's going to stand before them? Who's going to represent me before those people? The idea is that fear will impede truth. It does every time. Do you know that there are many people just like me and you who are sitting in here today who know the truth, but we're afraid to share it with people outside? You know why we have fear? Well, what will my mom think? What will my dad think? You know? These people will think we're crazy. Well, we can be as crazy as a lunatic. But if we don't share this with them, they are going to die in inner outer darkness because we fail to stand and tell them the truth. Amen? Who will stand before the Anak? Who will challenge them with truth? If we don't do it, who's going to? I would suggest to you this. There's a lot of people out here who may be small people. But they think that they're giants in the area of wisdom and knowledge. And they're going to try to use that against you and me. And if we don't know the truth and don't know how to present the truth, they're never going to make it. What is a remnant? Could be a very, very small number. But Yahweh has much more to say about the issue. So, let's look at what he does say. And you shall know today that Yahweh your Elohim is he who is passing over before you as a consuming fire. He does destroy them and subdue them before you. So you shall dispossess them and destroy them quickly, as Yahweh has said to you. My point is this. The giants that stand before us in opposition to us, he's going to take out of the way. All we need to do is trust in him. Have faith in him. Believe in him. Trust him fully. He says, I'm going to take care of that. I don't have to. You don't have to. The one I trust will take care of them. And you know what? He don't care how big they are, does he? Not at all. If there's a mountain before us, what does he tell us to say to the mountain? Yep. Before Yahweh destroys the enemy, Israel is challenged with believing that he's able. I want you to please get that. Before he will remove the enemy that is before you, before he will remove the opposition that is before you, before he takes any action, he wants to know that you believe that he is able to do it. And if there's doubt in your mind, guess what's going to happen? He's not going to do it. I have to fully believe that he's able to do it. Does Scripture ever tell me that he's able to do it?
Yes.
Ephesians 3:20. To him who is able to do exceedingly above what we ask or think, according to the power that is working in us. Now I want you to notice something about this little passage here from Ephesians. What I want you to notice is talking about Yahweh who is able. You see that? And he's able to do exceedingly above anything that we can ask or anything we can think. That means even anything we can imagine. All right? He's greater than anything. He's omnipotent, all powerful. But notice what it says. According to the power that is what? Working in us. He accomplishes what he accomplishes through us. There are those out here who believe in the 144,000, if you remember about the 144,000.
Yeah.
They can't be killed. A lot of people teach that, they can't be killed. Well, there's reason to believe now they can be killed, but they'll be immediately resurrected to life. You can't keep them dead. You kill them, they instantly come back to life. How does that happen? The power that works in us. Do not think in your heart. Now pay attention to this. How many of you, when you read these words in the Torah, you read these words anywhere in the Scripture, and it says, do not think in your heart. Do you ever stop and ask, well, wait a minute. I've always been taught that I think in my mind. I use my brain to think. But this doesn't say this. It says, think in your heart. Do not think in your heart. How do I think in my heart? Well, let's look. Do not think in your heart after Yahweh your Elohim has driven them out before you, saying, because of my righteousness, Yahweh has brought me in to possess this land. But it is because of the wrong of these nations that Yahweh is driving them out from before you. Don't let the thinking process reach the core of your being, where all of the real belief and truth is housed, into fooling yourself into thinking that I'm so great. We need to remember that Yeshua HaMashiach said, in me nothing is impossible, but without me you can do nothing. We do well to remember that. Anything that I do, anything that I accomplish, is not ever because of me. It's because of he who lives in me. I couldn't do anything without him. How many of you know this? You couldn't even take another breath without him. If you remove him from the picture, your life is over. Actually, this passage, though, does not say do not think in your heart. What it does say is do not speak in your heart. Do not amar. Amar doesn't mean to think. Mar means to speak. So, now let's look at it. See, we have a little different perspective here now. Do not speak amar in your heart. Amar, there's the word amar in Hebrew. Chain of words to form a sentence, to speak. How are miracles created? Speaking. Right? How did he create the heavens and the earth? He spoke them into existence. Right? How did he create you and me?
He breathed faith into what he created.
Yeah. It is not because, notice now how many times he repeats this same kind of phrase. It is not because of your righteousness or the uprightness of your heart that you go in to possess their land, but because of the wrong of those nations that Yahweh your Elohim drives them out from before you in order to establish the word which Yahweh swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Yitzhak, and to Yaakov. I just saw Mary hold up three fingers. It tells me she's been studying. Three times he says, it isn't because of you, Israel. It isn't because you're so good and so great. It's because they are so evil and wicked and bad. Right? And so let's continue to look. But he says, why is he doing it? In order to establish the word which he swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Right? Righteousness has to do with halakha. When you become a righteous person, you walk out that righteousness. You function in righteousness. You do that which is right in His sight. And how do you know what's right in His sight? Because you also have Agadah. You have learned what it takes to be a righteous person before Him. And then you begin to walk that out. Righteousness, Zadak, comes from the word Zadak. One who walks a straight path. Now I have to wonder, when people out here in the world are reading their Bibles and they come across this word, righteousness, if they understand that it means to walk a straight path, and if it does, if they understand that much, do they understand what that path is? I mean, it's not enough to just say one who walks a straight path. I have to ask myself, what path? Does Yahweh mention to us anything about a path? Yeah, numerous times, doesn't he? And he connects that to what? His word, the Torah, which are the words of life. It was not that Israel was so good. It was because the Goyim were so wrong. I'm going to look at that a little more here in a moment. Has Israel at any time ever, have we ever really been as a nation obedient?
No.
Never. We have individuals who have been obedient, but the nation itself has never, ever been completely obedient. Here is a word, Rishah. In Hebrew, wicked. Wicked means to destroy the function or the design of something. So when Yahweh talks about people being wicked or a nation being wicked, what he's actually talking about is they are trying to destroy the function of something, how something works, or the design of something. Now I want you to think about that. in the context of what happens in today's society. Are there people out there who are trying to destroy the function of the Torah? They are, right? And are they trying to destroy the design of the Torah? Yeah, in fact, they're trying to make it non-applicable at all. Meaningless. I mean, but how does one learn what a straight path is? It's called, again, Agadah. Agadah is the learning process. This is where I learn what is a straight path. This is where I ask questions of my Abba, of my Father. Abba, what do you mean when you say straight path? Show me in the Word. What do you mean by a straight path? And believe me, He'll show you. I'm going to go out on a limb and tell you. I believe that the solution to every problem of life is in the Torah. The answer is there somewhere. But you know what you have to do? Study. Study. Verse 6, and you shall know that Yahweh your Elohim is not giving you this good land to possess because of your righteousness. For you're a stiff-necked people. How many times is that now he said it? This is the third time. Okay, he said essentially the same thing. Three times. Once in verse 4, once in 5, and one in 6. Yahweh reminds Israel of his reason for giving them the land. Three times his covenant. It was due to the covenant he made with Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. It had nothing to do with the goodness of the people called Israel. It had to do with the goodness of himself who made a covenant with these people. And he says, I will not break the covenant. I keep the covenant regardless of what Israel does. The covenant, I made it and I'm going to keep it. Who broke the covenant? Wasn't him. Verse 7, remember, do not forget how you provoked to wrath Yahweh your Elohim in the wilderness. From the day you came out of the land of Mitzrayim until you came to this place, you have been rebellious against Yahweh. Now, who is he talking to right now? A whole generation has died in the wilderness. That generation is gone. He's talking to the children of that generation who will now go into the land. Not the generation of the people that died in the wilderness. And he's reminding them to look at your parents, look at your grandfathers, look and see what they did. And don't do what they did. Don't repeat the sins of those people. And guess what? He's telling all of us the same thing today, isn't he? He's saying, those things were an example so that you don't make that same mistake. Study it. Show yourself approved. Do what is right. Do what is honorable. Honor the King.
Trust you.
It says you provoked. This was interesting to me. You provoked Yahweh Elohim. There you see this word kasav. Means to lash out in anger. So it isn't just, see, we get the impression sometimes that Israel, when they were in the wilderness, the generation that died in the wilderness, that they were just disobedient. It wasn't just that they were disobedient. They screamed out at Yahweh. They treated him in utter disdain. Probably even called him names. They lashed out. Provocation is a sure sign of an anti-Messiah spirit. The evidence of this is against the word of Yahweh, anger, cursing, blaspheming, or deception. Those are listed in the scriptures that you have lying in front of you. The spirit of anti-Messiah. And this is a sure sign of that. So here I'm going to tell you once again, It's a good idea for everybody to learn about the realms of death. Learn what they are. Learn what the fruit or the evidence of those things are. Learn about them so that you can identify them when you see them and you can address the problems. It is not just that Israel complained in the wilderness. They displayed a rebellious, wicked spirit of anti-Messiah. Verse 8, even in Horeb, you made Yahweh wroth, so that Yahweh was enraged with you to destroy you. Isn't it sad that he originally created us in his own image and likeness, and then he comes to the point where he says, I wish I'd never made you. I'm so sick of you, I want to destroy all of you. Horeb is in Mount Sinai, or is Mount Sinai. The word is taken from another Hebrew word, Harab. Harab means a dry wasteland. How many of you ever thought about Mount Sinai as being like a plush place with green pastures and leads you up to this beautiful mountain with trees and bushes and grass and all of that? Actually, it's described as a dry wasteland. When I went up to the mountain to receive the tablets of stone, the tablets of the covenant which Yahweh made with you, then I stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. I did not eat bread, nor did I drink water. Now there's something coming up here that's very interesting. Was to me, I hope it'll be interesting to you. He didn't eat anything and he didn't even drink water. Now, do you think you could go 40 days without drinking water? Do you think you could make it 40 days without eating? We could, but I doubt anybody in this room could go 40 days without water. I doubt that seriously. The number 40 represents a probationary period of time. It was a period of time for Israel to consider their covenant responsibility. But during the 40 days that Moshe was up on the mountain, was not a time for Israel to just do what they did. It was a time for contemplation for Israel to think about the things they had done and to think about what was in the future for them. It was a probationary period. You know what it reminds me of? And I'm guilty of this. I'm just going to have true confession. At one time, I was a co-pastor. And the pastor of this guy, he was a black man. And he had a facility that was being donated to the ministry. And I was his associate. And he said, well, you stay here. I've got to go talk to the people that are going to donate this to us. And he said, I'll be back in a little while. Well, when he came back, we were all just standing around, me and the congregation. And I'll never forget what he asked me. He said to me, why are you standing around here? And I said, well, there's nothing to do. He said, do you ever hear of praying? He said, instead of standing around here, he said, you should have been on your knees praying while I'm in there talking to the guy that's going to donate this to us. Well, I'll tell you what, that got to me. That really got to me. Because he was absolutely right. Okay? Instead of turning out to be a time of spiritual deliberation, they focused on idolatry. Isn't that interesting? Here they face to face all the time with the works and wonders that were created right in their midst. And instead of thinking about that, they think about idolatry. Things like this never cease to amaze me. Verse 10. Then Yahweh gave me the two tablets of stone. Pay attention to this. The two tablets of stone written with the finger of Elohim. And on them were all the words which Yahweh had spoken to you on the mountain from the midst of the fire in the day of the assembly. Now, you know, we find recorded 10 words. Do you mean to tell me that it took only 10 words for him to speak everything from Mount Sinai? Everything he said only took 10 words? You ever think about that? Okay. How did Yahweh write the words on stone? Did he use fire as the movies depict? What do you think? You know, you saw in the movie, the Exodus, fire comes out of his fingertip and he writes all these things. Does the Torah tell us, really, how he did this? Did he really burn it into stone with his finger? Well, let's look. The word finger here is the word in Hebrew, etzba. The finger or toe. Did he write it with his toe? Don't think so. With his finger. Etzba is from another Hebrew word, saba. Saba means to dip into coloring or a dye. So now based on that, how do you think he wrote on the stone? He dipped his finger in a color or a dye, according to this, right? No place does it tell me he burned it with fire. So. And it came to be, it might say that somewhere, but I haven't come across it. It came to be at the end of 40 days and 40 nights that Yahweh gave me the two tablets of stone, the tablets of the covenant. It's mentioning over and over two tablets of stone. Don't miss the fact that two. All right? Then Yahweh said to me, arise, go down quickly from here, for your people whom you brought out of Mizraim have acted corruptly. They have quickly turned aside from the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded image. Now why is it that sometimes it tells us Yahweh brought them out of Egypt, out of the land of Mizraim, and here he says, for your people whom you brought out of Mizraim? I think, you know, and what he's saying is, I brought these people out in righteousness. These people have turned to idolatry. These are the people you brought out. I brought out the people who would have followed me, should have followed me. Okay. They quickly turned aside from the way which I commanded them. It wasn't just they corrupted something. They actually corrupted themselves. Sin corrupts people as well as nature. Your and my sins even affect nature. Did you know that? Why is that? Because of frequency. When we curse something, there is a completely different frequency that comes out of us than when we bless something. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. And it has an effect on whatever else is out there. Yahweh spoke to me saying, I have seen this people, and look, they are a stiff-necked people. Leave me alone so that I destroy them and blot out their name from under heavens, and make of you a nation stronger and greater than they. Now he told us a little earlier, they were greater than we are, and they were stronger than we are. But now he's telling Moses here, that if you'll let me destroy all of Israel, I'll make you a greater person. Now I want you to think about this in the context of yourself. Suppose you're Moses, and you have an option. You have all of these people that you know and love called Israel, and you have Yahweh Elohim who you love more than anything, including them. Yahweh Elohim comes to you and says, Moses, I'm going to destroy this whole nation of people. I'm going to let you live. And what I'm going to do, Moses, is I'm going to create a whole new generation of people that are greater and stronger than these people were, and you're going to be over all of them. What would you do? Think about what would you do? Yah made Moses an offer he couldn't refuse. But he did. Moses could have begun all over with a new nation of people. Moses could have been president, but he refused. Why? Anybody know the answer to that? Why? Because he loved his people, Israel. When you look around in this room, you ask yourself this question. Silently to yourself, not out loud. As you look around this room and you say to yourself, is there anybody in here that I would not give my life for? Is there anybody seated in here today that I wouldn't willingly die for? So that they can live. Did I miss that? Oh, so I turned and came down from the mountain, and the mountain burned with fire, and the two tablets of the covenant were in my two hands. Don't miss this. There were two tablets in my two hands. See, we miss so much because we just don't grasp Hebraically what Yahweh is really saying to us here. These things are important, okay? Let's look. Did you ever question why there were two tablets? Why couldn't he just take one big tablet and wrote it on there? Instead of two tablets. Why did he have one in one end, one in the other? Well, let's look. Two tablets, two hands. One for the relationship with our Creator and the other with our fellow man. If you look at the tablets that contain the 10 words, 5 of those have to do with our relationship with Yahweh, and the other 5 have to do completely with our relationship with one another. Love Yahweh your Elohim with all of your heart, soul, and so forth. Love your fellow man as yourself. Right? So we have two, that's relationships. Relationship with Him and relationship with one another. I mean, this is why this is important. And I looked and saw that you had sinned against Yahweh your Elohim and had made for yourself a molded calf. You had quickly turned aside from the way which Yahweh had commanded you. Sin wasn't the result of the molded calf. I want you to please get this. Sin was not the result of the molded calf. The molded calf was a result of sin. What was the sin of Israel? So they sinned because they were out of fellowship with Yahweh. And so they made an idol. Right? Turning aside from the Torah, turning from life to death, failing to keep the commandments. That's the sin of Israel. And the sin of Israel then causes you to do what? Turn to idolatry. Verse 17. And I took the two tablets and threw them out of my two hands and broke them before your eyes. What is he saying? You broke fellowship with the Most High and you broke fellowship with one another. You're out of fellowship completely. Right? The covenant with Yahweh as well as the covenant with one another was broken by Israel. And I fell down before Yahweh as at the first, 40 days and 40 nights. So he's going to repeat this again. I did not eat bread and I did not drink water. Because of all of your sins which you committed in doing evil in the sight of, in the eyes of Yahweh to provoke him. Remember what we said about provocation a little earlier. Now here is something important. I want you to notice the pattern. Moshe worshipped before Yahweh. He fasted and prayed, right? For 40 days, Moshe was fed spiritual food. He said, I fell before him. That's worshiping him. Okay? Then it tells us that he did without bread and water. That's fasting. So first of all, before he did anything else, he worshiped, right? Evil. That is the word that I mentioned a little earlier, Risha, means wickedness, to destroy the function or design of something. There have always been those who want to alter the function of the Torah or to redesign the words to fit their own agenda or preconceived ideas. Deuteronomy 19:9-19. For I was afraid of the displeasure and rage with which Yahweh was wroth with you to destroy you. But Yahweh listened to me that one time, or listened to me that time once more. So he pleaded, he prayed, he fasted, and Yahweh listened to him. The first time is recorded in Shemot chapter 32, verse 14. The first insert of this. And Yahweh was very enraged with Aharon to destroy him, so I prayed for Aharon at that time also. And I took your sin, the calf which you had made, and burned it with fire, and crushed it, and ground it very small, until it was fine as dust. And I threw its dust into the stream that came down from the mountain. The calf was the evidence of spiritual failure within Israel. Is the evidence. Sin is ultimately purged with fire. This is what Moshe did. Purged it with fire. And at Teberah and Massah and Kibroth Hattaavah, you made Yahweh wroth. And when Yahweh sent you from Kadesh Barnea, saying, go up, possess the land which I've given you, then you rebelled against the mouth of Yahweh your Elohim, and you neither trusted him nor listened to his voice. Boy, what a charge that is. Me? Rebel. Here is a word. Rebel means, in Hebrew, means mara, to be bitter, to disobey, to rebel against. So Israel became bitter against Yahweh. Israel destroyed, or disobeyed rather, Israel disobeyed the words of Yahweh. In doing so, they became bitter. Bitterness resulted in unbelief. How many people have ever come to the place where they lost something that's very, very important to them, and it caused them to no longer believe in Yahweh? When he fails our belief system, what we think he should do, sometimes we turn against him. We rebel against him. We become bitter. How many of you ever heard the word, these words, bitter root judgment? You have been rebellious against Yahweh from the day that I knew you. Moses says, you've always been a miserable lot. From the day I met the first one of you, every one of you have been rebellious. And they still are. Right? If you don't believe that, just look around you. Okay? So I fell down before Yahweh the 40 days and 40 nights. For I fell down because Yahweh had said he would destroy you. And I prayed to Yahweh and said, O Master Yahweh, do not destroy your people and your inheritance, whom you have redeemed in your greatness, whom you brought out of Mitzrayim with a strong hand. I noticed a pattern here. Worship always preceded prayer. Praise invites him in. Worship opens his heart to receive our prayer. That's the pattern that's given. I'm going too fast. Are we okay? Verse 27, remember your servants Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. Do not look upon the stubbornness of this people or their wrongdoing or their sin. Now I want you to think about that for a minute. Really want you to digest those words. Moses is looking at the Creator of heaven and earth who cannot stand sin. And he's saying, don't look upon the stubbornness of this people or on their wrong or their sin. He's saying, Abba, it's okay. They're a bunch of lousy sinners, but it's no big deal. Is that what he's saying? That's what it sounds like, though, right? Just ignore the fact that they're a bunch of miserable sinners, right?
Yes, but they had Yah's heart.
What is Moshe asking Yahweh to do? What is he really asking him to do?
Righteousness.
Moshe is not saying that Yahweh should excuse these things. He's asking him to remember his covenant of promise. We miss this. He's saying, yes, they sin. Yes, they do wrong. Yes, they do all of these things. But you made a covenant with them. Are you going to forsake your own covenant? Or are you going to deal with Israel? Right? Why? Lest the land from which you brought us should say, because Yahweh was not able to bring them to the land which he promised them, and because he hated them, he has brought them out to kill them in the wilderness. And they are your people and your inheritance, whom you brought out by your great power and your outstretched arm. Abba, remember, you did these things. And now you're going to turn your back on him, on Israel? You did all of these things. You brought them out. You promised them these things. Right? And now you're going to leave the impression by Mitzrayim that you don't care about any of us. You brought us out here to kill us all. What's it going to say about you? When we speak the word, it shows Yahweh that we study the word. That we know his promises and we stand firm on them. That's what Moshe was doing. He said, Abba, I didn't make these promises. I didn't make this covenant. You did. These are your words. These are your promises. What are you going to do? Right?
Also, one of the things that people did is not just for his name's sake, but he made the covenant with Abraham where he walked between them.
That's right. It was his covenant. Until next time. Study to show yourselves approved.
But my point was, wasn't it that if the covenant was broken, that Yahweh himself would suffer the consequences?
Where's the picture?
It'll be up right there. She's asking me a question. I ask what now?
Wasn't it that because Yahweh did the walking through, for both, he did the covenant for both Abraham and himself? Was that Abraham that he had fallen asleep?
Yeah.
And so, wasn't it that if the covenant was broken, that Yahweh would be responsible for both sides?
It's the impression that Moshe is saying it would make it look like he was responsible for it, whether he was or not.
I know, but what I'm asking is, when we studied that covenant that he made with Abraham, wasn't that the end result of that, the covenant that he made was that because he did the walking through and put Abraham asleep, that meant that Yahweh would be responsible with either side.
For both sides, yes.
Yeah, he would break the covenant. Yeah, but he didn't break the covenant.
No, I know, but I'm just thinking, you know, is that part maybe of what Moshe was reminding him?
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. He's reminding him that it's your covenant. If you do this, it's going to look like you broke covenant and killed all of us.
Okay. I didn't get that.
Yeah.
Let's see.
You know what? That's exactly what I do.